Many hormones, neurotransmitters, and other signaling molecules exert their effects through what's called the G-protein coupled receptor, PLC, IP3, DAG, PKC, signaling pathway. Let's take a look at it. Well, no matter what the signal is, this pathway is going to begin with the GPCR, G-protein coupled receptor. Those are members of that 7 membrane spanning domain family that are associated with heterotrimeric G-proteins. Cells have a number of different types of G-proteins. There are several different G-alpha subunits, several different beta and gamma subunits. For this particular pathway, the G-protein that's involved is the G-alpha-Q type. Now, in the absence of signal, this pathway's off, and I can tell it's off because the GPCR is associated with all 3 subunits of the G-protein, and in addition, the alpha subunits associated with the GDP. This is what it looks like when the pathway is off. Well, what happens if we add a signaling molecule? Well, the molecule will come and bind to its receptor, and that binding induces a conformational change. Because the receptor and the G protein are closely associated, there's a corresponding change in the G protein. And what will happen is the G alpha subunit will drop that GDP molecule and pick up a GTP molecule instead. Once the alpha subunit is bound to GTP, it loses its affinity for the receptor. It also loses its affinity for the beta and the gamma subunits. They'll diffuse away through the membrane, the beta and the gamma separately, and the alpha separately. Let me move this over so we can see what happens next. The main target for the activated alpha subunit is a protein called phospholipase C. As the name suggests, this is an enzyme. It's going to cleave phospholipids. So to show you how this works, I'm going to go ahead and blow up just a little bit of this membrane so we can talk about it. So here's a little bit of the phospholipid bilayer, and I'll just remind you that there are 2 rows of phospholipids, and they're arranged so that the polar heads are facing either the cytoplasm or the extracellular space, and the fatty acid tails are in between. There are a number of different phospholipids that you can find in the membrane. On the cytoplasmic side, one of the types that we find is a molecule called phosphatidylinositol bisphosphate, PIP2. And here I've drawn it, and I've highlighted the polar head in gray, and then those 2 fatty acid tails in blue. This is the substrate for phospholipase C. If it's activated, it's going to take this molecule and clip it into 2 pieces, inositol triphosphate, which is going to be polar, and then diacylglycerol, which is nonpolar and will remain in the membrane. Well, let's go back and look at the pathway again. The activated G-alpha subunit binds to the phospholipase C, and that induces a conformational change, so that now the phospholipase C's active site is revealed and it's in a position where it can bind to its substrate. The phospholipase C will cleave its substrate, generating DAG, which stays in the membrane, and IP3. The main target for the IP3 is the endoplasmic reticulum. This is one of the structures in the cell that sequesters calcium. There are pumps that move calcium in so that there's a high concentration of calcium inside the lumen, and there's very little free calcium in the cytoplasm. The calcium can't leave through the membrane, but there is an IP3-gated calcium release channel, so that if IP3 gets added to this system, it can bind to the channel, opening it up, and then calcium can flood out of the ER into the cytoplasm, where it can exert a number of different actions. Well, what about the other breakdown product? What about DAG? Well, DAG can diffuse through the membrane, and it can encounter a protein called protein kinase C. Almost every cell has protein kinase C. There are a few different types, but the most typical protein kinase C is activated by binding DAG and calcium. And if both of those components are bound, then the molecule is activated. Kinases can then phosphorylate their target proteins, again, leading to a host of different effects downstream. Well, these are the basics of the pathway. Now let me give you a couple examples. The first example I'm going to give you comes from mast cells. Mast cells are part of your immune system. They are filled with vesicles that are loaded with a bunch of different effectors. If they are activated, say by seeing histamine or substance P, then that induces the fusion and release of those granule contents, and the release of those compounds then will mount an inflammatory response in that region. Well, how do histamine or substance P lead to this change? Well, that involves this pathway. When the signaling molecule binds to GPCR, it activates it, activating phospholipase C, leading to an increase in IP3 and DAG. That IP3 can lead to the release of calcium and increase the cytoplasmic calcium levels. In this system, in this cell, there's a role for DAG as well. DAG can bind to a particular type of calcium channel called the trip calcium channel and directly activate it, opening it up so even more calcium comes into the cell. And together, the calcium from the internal stores and that's entered through the trip channel lead then to the fusion of these granules through calcium-mediated exocytosis. There's also a role for PKC. Activation of PKC by calcium and DAG can lead to phosphorylation of a number of factors, including some transcription factors that will regulate gene expression. Here's another example involving tracheal smooth muscle contraction. We breathe in air through our trachea, and those trachea are surrounded by smooth muscle. If the muscle contracts, then less air will be drawn in. If the muscle is relaxed, then more air can be drawn in. And the activity of those muscles is under the control of the nervous system. So here I've drawn a smooth muscle cell and a nerve cell that's innervating it. And if that nerve cell releases a transmitter serotonin, well then what happens is serotonin binds to the GPCR, activating phospholipase C so that we get the production of IP3 and DAG. Once again, IP3 can lead to the release of calcium into the cytoplasm. Calcium can do a number of different things in this system, but one of the things that it can do is it can bind to a protein called calmodulin, and together the calcium calmodulin can turn on a protein called myosin light chain kinase. When myosin light chain kinase is on, it can phosphorylate its target protein, which is myosin. When myosin is phosphorylated, it becomes activated, it can walk along actin. That's muscle contraction. PKC has a role in this system as well. If DAG and calcium both bind to it, it will be activated, and one of the target proteins that can be activated by protein kinase C is myosin light chain phosphatase. The myosin light chain phosphatase is an enzyme that would normally remove that phosphate group from the myosin, and if it's blocked, this can't happen, prolonging contraction. So in the presence of serotonin, we get stronger and longer lasting contraction. Well, these are two different cells, two different signals, two different sets of downstream effects, but the players in between, the GPCR, the phospholipase C, the IP3 DAG, and the PKC, those are the same, and that's the basic pathway.